Testing 1, 2, testing. Hey, God bless you and good evening, Bridge Church of Alabama and my family and friends that are out there across the ways, the miles, the roads, the avenues. Bless you. This is Pastor T coming to you live from the Bridge Church of Alabama here in our most famous city called Opelika, Alabama. Wanted to thank you all for coming in. Thank you for joining us tonight. We're looking forward to having a wonderful Bible study. I pray that all is well with each and every one of you. Wanted to begin our Bible study tonight just with a little background. Just wanted to take the time out to thank our Deacon Carlos Corbett for giving us a Bible study last Wednesday night. If you were tuned in with us last Wednesday night, he taught on selfishness, which is something that we all need to maybe examine and take self-inventory every now and then, knowing and understanding that selfishness is part of the old sinful nature. And if we're still exhibiting that selfishness the way he taught it last Wednesday, if we're still exhibiting that, then there's some things that we need to go to the altar about. We need to see the Lord and have him work some things out in our lives. And so he talked about that. And tonight, I'm going to be picking back up where we left off. Some of you may wonder, well, why did I stop in the middle of a lesson? Well, this is basically, I will probably call it, continuation from the previous lesson, but we're going in a different direction, but yet it's still the same vein, if that makes sense. We're still coming and talking in reference to how Satan attacks us and the means that he uses and what he uses to do that. And so last Wednesday night Bible study, really, it is still a way that we can look at how Satan still attacks our minds, because even in selfishness, we know that selfishness is something that is embedded based on what we have learned, based on who we are. And so tonight we're going to continue on. What I wanted to do is pick back up. Before we begin, though, of course, I'd like to pray ask the Lord that he will come in and teach tonight's Bible study. So if you're with me tonight, let's say a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for tonight's lesson. I pray now, Lord, that you will teach your people, God, that you just use me as your vessel, but I'm praying that you will use only that which is necessary tonight, Lord. You teach your people tonight, God. Teach us, God, that we will be better than what we were when we first started this lesson. We thank you now, and we give you our hearts that you may pour into us. We receive now the very goodness, the very best that you have for us, Lord. We receive it now. And we pray, Father, if there's anything that will stop or block your pouring into us tonight, Father, we ask that you remove it. We ask now, Father, that you allow it to be a free flow of the anointing upon the teaching of your word tonight. We thank you now, God, that you are with us always, that you have never left us, nor will you ever forsake us. We thank you tonight that tonight's lesson, Father God, will be one that we will carry all the days of our lives, God, and will continue to pick us up and motivate us and inspire us to be the very best that we can be for you and your kingdom. We bless you tonight for the results that we're going to receive by faith. We believe in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Well, I wanted to begin our last time I was here, and some of you remember, you joined us 2 weeks ago. We were talking about how Satan attacks us and the means that he do so. So I'd like to use our foundational scripture. We will. Let's go to 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5. That's our foundational scripture. And I'm going to go into the King James Version. Well, let's go to the New Living Translation first, and then we'll go back into it with the King James Version. So the New Living Translation says, it reads like this: we are human, but we don't wage war as humans do. We use God's mighty weapons, not worldly weapons, to knock down the strongholds of human reasoning and to destroy false arguments. We destroy every proud obstacle that keeps people from knowing God. We capture their rebellious thoughts and teach them to obey Christ. We'll stop right there. Now let's go into the King James Version. In the same verses, we're going to read verses 3 through 5 again. It says, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. I'm going to stop right there. And so, as we've been talking over the last several weeks, as I've been teaching, we've been talking about the warfare that we're in and the attack that we have, and that the Bible plainly states that we're not fighting a war that's physical. We're fighting a war that is a spiritual warfare. And so what we did, we moved forward and we discussed how the enemy, because we talked about that, and we made it plain to see in the scripture that our enemy is Satan. And the Bible says that Satan desires to sift us as wheat. He desires to make us into nothing, basically. Nothing but powder in the hand and blow us forward. Well, we know that the way that he attacks us, we went on to say that the way that Satan attacks us is by means of information. And we talked about that, and we talked about the breakdown of the body and the human body rather, and how the body is broke down into three parts. And so we're gonna go back to, let's go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. It says, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, and I pray, God, your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Here, Paul is saying that our entire makeup, who we are, our entire being is made up of three parts, our soul, our spirit, our soul, and our body. And then we went a little bit further. We talked about those three parts. And we said that the spirit makes us God aware. Basically, our spirit is what God has blown into mankind, and it makes us spiritual aware of who he is. It's called knowing. It gives us an indication once we get to a place in our lives where we basically understand right from wrong, we begin to seek after that which is right. But when that desire in you, that spiritual desire in you wants to know what's right, it always leads you to a relationship to a potential relationship that you can have with God, because we're all created by him, so we're drawn to him. Always, from the day we're born into this world, we're drawn to him, not forcefully, but drawn to him because we're created by him. And so we're drawn to go back to the creator from the time we're born all the way to the time we die. Now, what God has done, though, God has given us a place where we're able to make decisions. It's called, what do we call that? Where we're, y'all with me? Where we're able to make decisions?
Choice,
thank you. We have choice. God has given us a choice where we live our lives making choices. And so we have to choose to go back to him. Uh-huh. He leads us. He lets us know that he's available. He's there for us.
Right.
But we have to choose to go back to him. And so our spirit being, our spiritual man, makes us aware of who God is. Uh-huh. And until you come into the knowledge of who God is, you really are not whole or complete.
Right.
It takes that relationship to make you whole and complete. As a matter of fact, Jesus said this. He said that the time will come where the true worshipers will worship me in spirit and in truth. Mm-hmm. And so the true worshiper, because the Bible goes on and says, because God is a spirit, and those that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And so our spirit part of us, the spirit man, makes us God aware.
Amen.
And then we have the soul. The soul makes us self-aware. That soul is where everything that we consist of in this human body, this human makeup, consists of our soul. We're going to come back to that in a second. Mm-hmm. And then it says that we're made up of the body. The body, of course, is self-evident. The body is what we carry around with, it's how we operate in this earth. It makes us earthly aware. It makes us aware of the earth. It makes us aware of our surroundings. It allows us, some people have called it an earth suit.
Right.
Because we are a spiritual being having natural experiences. We're not a natural being having a spiritual experience. We're spiritual beings having natural experiences. Mm-hmm. And so because we're having to live in this world, God put us in a world suit, mm-hmm. a body suit. And so let's go back to the soul part. And we discussed that. We said that the soul consists of three parts. The soul consists of three parts. The soul of the man consists of three parts. The soul of the man consists of the mind, his will, and his emotions.
Yes.
I'll say it again. The soul part of man consists of his mind, his will, and his emotions. Mm-hmm. Now, we broke this down the last time I was teaching. We broke this down and we said that the way Satan enters into our lives is through our soul. Utilizing those things that our soul consists of. Mm-hmm. And we said that the first part of our soul is the mind. And we said that it is in the mind that we our intellect is developed. It's in our mind that our reasoning is developed. It's in our mind that we have our thought process. So everything happens in our mind. Now all of this happens in terms of our intellect, our reasoning, our thought process, all of this takes place with the added information that we receive into our lives.
Right.
So we reason based on information. Our intellect, how smart we are, how smart we're not, is based on the information that we receive.
Right.
our thought process, everything we decide to do, when we think about it, everything we decide to do is based on our thought process, based on the information that we receive into our lives. And so we said, we went back and we talked about it. We said, what weapon did Satan use to convince Adam and Eve to sin? The bottom line was that he didn't use a weapon. Well, the weapon that he used was not a weapon that, in terms of a gun, a club, a knife, anything like that. His weapon was the gift of gab. His weapon was a gift of influence. Mm-hmm. So he influenced Eve and he influenced Adam to sin. Mm-hmm. And that has been his method from the very beginning. Satan has used that method to influence man. Mm-hmm. And he influences us through the means of information. Whatever information that he can put into our minds, and we grab it and we gravitate to it, the results will come out of whatever is deposited in us.
Okay.
Now we said that we have to be wise enough though to understand what information is coming from God and what information is coming from Satan.
Right.
We have to be wise enough and have a spirit of discernment to know what's good and what's bad. Not so much what's good, but what's righteous and what's bad. Because everything that's good does not mean that it's good. Because our interpretation of good may not be God's interpretation of good. So I like to seek after not so much the meaning of good, but the meaning of righteous. Because righteousness basically comes from the understanding of who God is and his way of operation. So we want to be righteous in everything we do. In order for us to live a righteous life, we have to live a righteous life based on the information that God has given us. Mm-hmm. Well, we know that God has given us the Holy Bible, which is filled with information.
Okay.
Filled with so much information in terms of allowing us to know what's right and wrong, what his expectations are, how we ought to live, how we ought to pray, how we ought to serve, how we ought to just live our lives in general in a way that pleases him. Now what Satan does, Satan comes and he takes that information and he tries to twist it.
Mm-hmm.
He twists it. He breaks it down and he twists it and he makes that information sound like it's coming from God, but it's not. Because what Satan does is that he takes what is the truth and he tries to deceive you into making you believe that a lie is now the truth. Mm-hmm. The Bible says in John, I believe it's John chapter 4, the Bible says that Satan is the father of lies. He's the father of lies. That's what he does. He practices it. He uses it. Every time he comes to you, he's bringing a lie. And sometimes that lie may look good. But if you're not in touch with God, if you're not in touch and you don't have a right relationship with God, then you'll take that lie and you apply it to your life. Basically, taking that information he's bringing you, taking that lie, which is information, you're taking it into your being and you begin to use it. What's disappointing is that we end up not getting results that we anticipate getting because we're taking what was meant for bad. It was deceptive. We thought it was for our good, and now we end up at the very end, and we didn't receive the results that we thought we were going to get. And then what happens? What? We go back to God. And then we have to go back to God and say, oh God, I messed up. Oh God, what happened? Oh God, I miss you. A lot of times we think we miss God. God has never even given. God is standing there saying, I gave you the information, but you allow Satan to come in there and distort it. So there we have it. We have basically we call it when I went back
and recap.
A recap of my last Bible study. And so I know I had a talk with a few people after that last Bible study that were pretty interested in that. A lot of things came out of that. And so we're going to move forward a little bit, just a little bit deeper in the lesson tonight. Except what I want to do is that I told you that we're going to be in the same vein, but pretty much kind of like going in a different direction. I don't know how many of you are familiar with this, but tonight and probably for the next couple of weeks, we're going to be talking about this book by John Bevere. John Bevere. Some of you may have read it already. It's called The Bait of Satan. The Bait of Satan. And this is really a good book. I admonish all of you, if you have not read it, to read it. I'm still in the middle of reading it, but what I've read so far is really good. I've had a lesson on it several, many, many years ago. And so I wanted to kind of like allow this lesson to piggyback off of my initial lessons that we've been teaching, because it really has a lot to say in terms of what we are going to be doing tonight. So I'm going to pause right here, see if anybody has any comments, anything like that, in reference to what we have been studying over the last couple of weeks. If not, then we're going to move forward. Any questions, any comments from the last couple of weeks? I want to address any some of those before we move forward into something different, which is not so much different, but into a different lesson tonight. Good? All right, well, let's do this. We're gonna start this lesson off. I'm pretty much gonna build a foundation tonight, and then we're probably gonna go deeper on the next couple of weeks. I mean, it's really a good lesson. I can't even tell you how long this is gonna last, because I don't wanna miss anything, but I want us to really get the meat of this. So let's do this. Let's go to Luke chapter 17. Now I wanna begin with the seventh, let's go on the New King James Version. Luke chapter 17, verse 5. Now what I'll end up doing is I'm gonna begin at this verse, but then I'm gonna kinda like backtrack a little bit. So let's go there. Luke chapter 17, verse 5. And it says this, "And the apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith." The apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. The apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. Now, this particular time frame is the latter part of Jesus' ministry. And you have to understand that there are a lot of things that the apostles have seen Jesus do. So with this being the latter part of his life, at this time, the disciples, the apostles, then says to Jesus, increase our faith. Now, I've got some things written down here. They have seen him raise people from the dead. They've seen him open up the eyes of the blind. They've seen him open the ears of those that were born deaf. Mm-hmm. They've seen him cause crippled people to walk. Mm-hmm. They've seen him feed 5,000 men and women, not including children, with just a few loaves of bread and two fishes. They watch him calm a threatening storm. I mean, there's so many things. But of all these different miracles that they've seen Jesus do, that at this particular junction in the scripture, it's only here that you hear the disciples, you hear the apostles say, "Lord, we can see there's a lot of doubt and we need you to increase our faith. There's some doubt that we still have in our lives. We need you to increase our faith." After everything he's seen, out of all those different things that God, Jesus had done, not once was it recorded for the disciples, that the disciples asked Jesus to increase their faith. Now, you may remember a particular story where Jesus came on the scene and the disciples were trying to deliver a sick young man who was overtaken by an evil spirit. And the father was asking the disciples to help heal this young boy. And Jesus got upset with the disciples because the disciples couldn't do it. And then Jesus turned to the boy's father and asked him, "Do you believe that your son can be healed?" And the father's response was, "Sir, I believe, but help my unbelief." Mm-hmm. It was the father that requested an increase of faith. Mm-hmm. Still, never has it been written or recorded in the Bible of the disciples or the apostles asking God or asking Jesus to increase their faith. So my question is, what was it that you think caused them at this point, this juncture, to ask Jesus to increase their faith? What was it at this juncture that required them to ask Jesus to increase their faith? And I really don't believe that it was just a simple Jesus increase our faith. I really don't believe that. I believe it was more like, whoo, Jesus, increase our faith. I believe that whatever it was, it struck them to a point where it was more of an exclamation than a statement or a simple request, a simple petition. Anybody out there, anybody want to bite on that question?
Well, I was going to say maybe because of what the things that they saw him do and the acts that he did perform, the miracles that did happen, that maybe they were thinking that in order for them to do greater works, I mean, probably what they were in their mind, they were probably like, there is no way we can do what he's doing. I mean, all of what he's doing, there is no way. And if you say that I have the capability to do this, I just, no.
Anybody else out there? You're real close there, the First Lady. Anybody else out there? Okay. Let me give you all, I know that you're working with us and there's probably a slow feed, so we're gonna try to give you an opportunity to catch up to us right now. Okay. 3 minutes? Wow. Wow, that's
could be weather.
Oh, could be the weather. Well, that's gonna really
We're gonna have to do
because I want to teach the lesson, but I don't want to teach it without the audience participation, so I don't want to go up. So y'all gonna have to do it. All right, well, y'all gonna have to participate tonight. I got like 4 people up in here, including myself, teaching tonight, and so we're gonna just utilize what we have up in here so that you all, but hopefully you all be able to ask your questions later on. I just love your comments, though. 3 minutes. Wow, Lord. All right, well, let's go to verse 3. Verse 3. What does verse 3 says? Verse 3 says, take heed to yourselves. If your brother sins against you, rebuke him, and if he repents, forgive him. Next verse. And if he sins against you 7 times in a day, and 7 times in a day returns to you, saying, I repent, you shall forgive him. Let's go to verse 5. And the apostle said to the Lord, increase our faith. So there you have it. That's the answer. It had nothing to do with all the miracles, nothing to do with all the things they've seen Jesus do. You would think they would have been asking, you know, Jesus, give me the same power to do what you're doing, or help me, give me more faith, or whatever the case may be.
Right.
It wasn't until Jesus said, you have to forgive your brother or your sister, 7 times in a day they come to you. It says, and if he sins against you 7 times a day, and 7 times in a day returns back to you, comes back to you 7 times, Jesus says, forgive him.
My Lord.
Forgive him. Now, based on the lessons we've been teaching, what do you think Satan is telling you if you're the one that has been sin against? What kind of information do you think Satan's bringing back to you? Let's say your brother stole, and I say, yeah, he's your brother, but he ain't been delivered yet. So let's say your brother stole $20 from you. And he doesn't call it stealing. He called it borrowing because y'all brothers and everything, or your sister took $20 from you, but she don't consider it stealing because y'all sisters and everything. And so they took it, saw it in the ashtray. You let them borrow your car. Come on, let's make this thing real good. You let them borrow your car. They borrow your car. They bring the car back. You know you had $20 in the ashtray. You go back, look for your $20. $20 gone. You address the person. Say, hey, I had $20 in the ashtray. The $20 is gone out of the ashtray. Did you take my $20? And the response is, yeah, I took it. I didn't think you would mind. I'll give it back to you. What happens at this point with you, Satan, and your friend or your sister?
I'm not sure what question he's answering, but Corey Dixon said, cut him off.
Cut him off?
Yes, I'm not sure, but did you ask a question before you went there?
Earlier, I did have a question.
You got to write those down.
Yeah, I did have a question.
Ask a question so that we'll know how to go back.
Yeah, I couldn't remember what that question was.
But he said, cut him off.
Cut him off. No, I can't remember what my question was. It came out of the Holy Ghost.
Right, we'll have to write them. We'll keep up with them. We'll write them down.
All right. But the last question was,
right,
based on the scenario I gave you, what's happening at that moment? The moment your brother or your sister responds back to you and says, yes, I took it. I didn't think you would mind. We brothers, we sisters, I'll get it back to you. What kind of information is going on in your head, in your mind right now? Go ahead, let me hear you.
He's a thief.
He or she is a thief. Minister Peacock, you out here, come on.
Corey says that that is what Satan would tell him to do, to cut the person off who took cash and car.
Cut the person off.
Yes.
Oh.
Shakira said he's saying you don't need him. He can't be trusted.
Gotcha. Good. Anybody else? Now let me add something to the scenario. This particular brother or sister is a brother or sister who just got saved 3 months ago, came to you by the way of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost leads people in your direction or leads you to them in their direction. You have walked them into a scenario where now they've given their life to Christ, but they're a babe in Christ. What do you do? Do you still cut them off? You've only known this person, you know, hey, three months. Yeah, you lend them the car. You lend them your car because you just want to be a help. You know how nice we are as Christians. We want to be, you know, Christian-like, you know, God-like. So we let them borrow the car because they just got out of the prison. They didn't have no transportation, or they, you know, just came out of not, you know, living on the streets, living in a car, whatever the case may be, living with kinfolk, but now they're trying to get back on their feet. But that's the scenario. They stole your money. Well, I don't want to use the word stole. They said they borrowed your money without asking, but they said they're going to give it back to you. What's your response? Do we still cut them off?
I don't think I would cut them off, but we would definitely have a serious conversation.
Okay.
Yeah. But you're saying, so after our serious conversation, this is what they tell me?
Yeah, this is what they tell you. Well, you asked.
Mm-hmm.
You asked what happened to your $20.
Mm-hmm.
They told you they borrowed it, but they're going to give it back to you. They never asked for it. They said they borrowed it. My thing is, and let's be real, let's keep it 100. There's a lot of information being poured into your consciousness right now. Satan is pouring some stuff into you. He's trying anyway. And so is the Holy Spirit. So I'm asking, what kind of information do you think Satan is telling you? What is it that Satan is telling you right now, or is trying to tell you right now?
About the person?
Yeah.
Cut them off.
That's what Satan is trying to tell you.
Yeah.
Okay.
To be offended, to cut them off.
Mm-hmm.
Really to disassociate with them. You can't trust them. I mean.
Right, right, exactly. And so I'm giving an example of what happens when a situation happens. So these are the things that happen and you don't have time to really see it coming. So my question is that can you see, because it's almost like playing a game show, you know, you're sitting home on the couch and you're watching someone on TV play it. We can give all the answers on the couch because we sit back and we got time to respond. But in the moment that this is taking place and you're the one under pressure, can you discern what's being said by Satan, and can you discern what's being said by the Holy Spirit?
Okay, Tiberius says, I would want to know why they borrowed or took it. The purpose. Satan is telling you to be mad and angry with that person and go against them. Cora says, Satan, I believe, would be telling me that the person is not really saved or they are a lost cause.
Okay. All right, let's do this. Let's go to verse 1 in the same chapter. Verse 1 in the same chapter. And this is Jesus still talking. Jesus says, then he said to the disciples, it is impossible that no offenses should come. But woe to him through whom they do come. Next verse. It would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were thrown into the sea, than that he should offend one of these little ones. So let's go back to verse 1. Let me read verse 1. Take heed to yourselves. Then he said to the disciples, it is impossible that no offenses should come, but woe unto him through whom they do come. Yes.
Okay, Debbie says, I wouldn't worry about the money. I'd tell them to forget it. But be mindful in the future and encourage them to ask if they need money or something.
Mm-hmm.
Shakira says, people may still feel like they should have asked first. The devil will make you think if they can take $20, they can take
$100. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that scenario, I gave that scenario to try to create a vision in your mind of things that will happen that will cause you to have to think about your actions. Most of the time, though, we don't think about our actions until after we've acted. And so what I want to get into tonight is how someone else's actions can cause us to be offended. Let's say, same scenario, that person that took the money, after you've spoken with them, you've given them your ideal of what you believe what should have happened. That person goes back and begins to talk about you with people, other people in the church, and say they came and asked you for money, and you, though you gave it to them, you didn't give it to them in a godly type manner with love. You were that the way you gave them the money, it really offended them. And so you get the word back that this person is talking about you behind your back. And by the time you get the story is the person really didn't take the money, but instead the person borrowed the money with your approval. But you were really reluctant when you gave it to them. And you made them feel bad for borrowing it, for them to have to borrow it. You made them feel bad because because of where they were coming from, you know, being homeless or just coming out of prison, you made them feel bad. And so now there's a rumor going around that you gave someone or reluctantly allowed this person to borrow some money, but you reluctantly did it, and how bad you made this person feel and look because of the way you did it. And now people are coming back sharing with you how you should have done better as a Christian, how your actions should have been more godly like. You said no.
But you can't make me feel some kind of way.
How are you gonna make me feel bad about me giving you my money?
But this is what people are doing though. People are coming back and they bring it back to your information, because now what was the truth has now been twisted into a lie. And so now the lie is back to you, and now you're in this place of, what happens to you? I don't want to say it, but what happens to you when you hear these rumors?
I get mad.
You get mad?
If I gave you my money, and if I didn't want you to have it, I wouldn't have given it to you.
Uh-huh. You get mad? Yeah? If I didn't want you to have it, I wouldn't have given it to you. Lady Latrilla, anything? Nothing? Okay. So rumors are coming back that you reluctantly gave this person your money. You made this person feel bad. Now you're made to seem like you were just bad Christian. What happens to you? What are you feeling? Nicole says she's angry. She gets angry. Anybody else? What are you feeling right now?
Shakira says at first you feel the need to defend yourself.
Need to defend yourself. That what she said, defend?
Well, she says, at first you feel per need to defend yourself. Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna say she's saying, the need.
Yeah, the need to defend yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Right, right. Mighty quiet, minister.
Just taking it all in, Pastor.
Okay. All right. Let me see. No one else has anything else to say. How many people we got out there tonight?
16.
Come on, 16 folks. Talk to me tonight.
I think
my question is out there.
Well,
I'm trying to build a mental picture of what happens when a situation, I mean, all I did was just try to describe a situation, and I'm just trying to see how people were reacting. The delay?
Mama Liz says, you have feelings of betrayal, then me and that person that spread the lie will need to talk.
Okay. All right. So going back to Luke chapter 17, verse 1. And let's go to the NLT version, Nicole, please.
And Shakira says you want to protect your character.
You want to protect your character. Luke chapter 17, verse 1 in the NLT version says, one day Jesus said to his disciples, there will always be temptations to sin, but what sorrow awaits the person who does the tempting. I like the King James version. Go back to the King James version. I'm sorry. Verse 1, one day Jesus said to his disciples, then said he unto the disciples, it is impossible but that offenses will come, but woe unto him through whom they come. Jesus is simply saying that there are going to be times in your life that you're going to be offended. Mm-hmm. Regardless of who you are, what you've done, he's saying you can't get around it. You live long enough on this earth, something is going to offend you. People will offend you. And the point of tonight's lesson is seeing why we get offended. What happens when we get offended? Why we get offended?
The message is good too.
The message, let me hear the message. Let me see the Message Bible. The Message Bible says, he said to his disciples, hard trials and temptations are bound to come, but too bad. for whoever brings them on. Too bad for whoever brings them on. Okay. Mike.
Concern that I'm having is when I read it and it says, woe unto them. So pretty much the saying, woe unto the person that offends you. So, but when I was growing up in the church, woe meant like, you know, that bad news, like, you know, you're about to get punished. Well, I feel sorry for the person that, I feel sorry for you, you know, woe unto that person. I feel sorry for that individual because something's about to happen.
Okay.
So when I see that, woe unto them, and I would say, like, in the layman's terms, if I'm being offended and nothing is happening to this individual that's offending me, and it's saying in the Bible that something will happen to this individual that offends me, but I don't see it, then initially I'll be defensive. I would probably want to be the one to make sure something happens, or, like, you know, clear my name, or, you know, go into a defensive posture. Because if I'm reading, it says, you know, you offend the child of God, then you the person that's about to offend me, something bad is about to happen to you. Uh-huh. But if I don't see it happening, then, you know, initially I'll have some questions, mm-hmm. and then I'll be in a defensive posture. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What Jesus is, now this particular verse one, and that's a good breakdown, Minister Dez, thank you. Now, verse one, what it's talking about here, though, is when it says, woe unto you, then said he unto his disciples, it is impossible but that offenses will come, but woe unto him through whom they come, meaning where the offenses, who the offenses are coming to, woe unto them who the offenses are coming to, because that offense that's coming to you depends on how you respond to it. Has a lot to do with how you're going to respond to the offense. The offense is coming. So woe unto you to whom that offense is coming. Why? Because that offense will cause you to react in a certain kind of way. You're going to respond. Woe unto you who the offense is coming, because you're going to respond. Let me say this. An offense, the Greek word for offense is called scandal. The Greek word for offense is and the old Greek word for offense is called scandal. Scandal. S-C-A-N-D-A-L. Scandal. I'm sorry, not scandal. Scandalon. 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 S-K-A-N-D-A-L-O-N. It's the Greek word for offense. Scandalon. Scandalon. S-K-A-N-D-A-L-O-N. That's a Greek word. Now let me describe something to you, how what used to happen back in the day. Now, with that old Greek word, how this is described, and this is how I kind of formatted in my reading. Back in the day, hunters would use, and some of you may be familiar with this type of hunting trap. Hunters would use something like a cage and with a flap on it, and then they would kind of like bait what they would call a scandalon, which is like a stick, where they would put bait on it, and they would put bait on the scandalon, and then they would cause, they would, of course, leave the area and come around and wait for either a bird or some type of animal, whatever it is that they're trying to catch or capture. They wait on that, and so they basically putting the type of bait that they want on the stick, and they wait for this animal to come. Well, lo and behold, eventually the animal comes, bites on the scandalon or the bait that's on the scandalon, and that causes the flap of the cage to drop, and it captures that particular animal. Well, this is where we get the bait of Satan from. What Satan does, he baits us the same way he does with this particular Greek word where we use scandalon. He uses information, which is just like a scandalon. He puts bait on it, and he causes us to come in the direction of where that information, again, go back to information, and we go after it. And then when we go after it, he captures us. Mm-hmm. That's why 2 Corinthians talks about it. He talks about that we're captive, that he we, that there's a place where he takes every high thought was exalt itself. Mm-hmm. We take it and we have to capture it because that's what he's trying to do. The word is infiltrate. Mm-hmm. Trying to infiltrate our minds with bait. And regardless of what type of bait it is, it doesn't matter what kind of bait it is, it's the type of bait that he knows you will come after. Mm-hmm. The type of bait that he knows that you have a taste for. Mm-hmm. And so if your makeup is you get offended easily because your feelings get hurt fast. Mm-hmm. So you get offended easy. What does Satan do? What kind of people, what kind of incidents or situations will he bring your way?
Right.
If he knows that you have an anger issue, if he knows that you have an issue with people talking about you, you know, just different things, regardless of what it is, he's going to bait you in. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's called the bait of Satan. He wants to bait you in. And so he uses this bait stick to cause you to come on in. And so this is what happens when we get into a place of offense. So when Jesus came back and he told the disciples, or he told the apostles, look, if your brother come back and he does something to you one time, forgive him. Most of us can forgive him one time. But then he comes back again, a second time, and a third time, and a fourth time. After a while, what Jesus is saying is, you're going to get offended. Uh-huh. Eventually, you're going to get offended. And that offense is, okay, are you taking advantage of me? Are you taking advantage of my kindness as a sign of weakness? Are you taking advantage of my Christianity, my Christian Christ-likeness? You know, what causes you to want to come to me and do this to me several times and expect me not to get offended? So how do we handle that? How do we handle the fact that, number one, things are going to come your way that may offend you? How do you handle it? What do you do? How do you handle it? How do you handle a person that wants to take advantage of you? How do you handle it? Because you got to remember now, going back to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, where it says that we wrestle not against flesh and blood. But yet, this person is coming to you in flesh and blood. How do you handle it?
The spiritual answer would be...
The spiritual answer
would be to walk after the spirit and not after the flesh. That would be the spiritual answer, because if that is the case, and this is the thing that I always try to remember, even in our personal, you and I, between you and I, is that I know that you love me, right?
Mm-hmm.
Vice versa. And so if there is anything that you say that offends me, I immediately think, okay, this person loves me. This is not typically how he says or talks to me. So, okay, either number one, he's mad about something else. Number two, there's something else going on. It's like a process, but I may not do that with everybody, but I do that, and sometimes I still miss it. But it's like you really have to be, because sometimes, a lot of times, especially like in this time and this season we're in right now, people have a lot on their mind.
Right, right.
And when they approach you and you're talking about something, they may have already come into your presence already upset, maybe because they can't pay a bill.
Yes.
Or they may already have things that are already heavy on them when they come into your presence.
Right.
We have some comments here. Tavoria says, and this is before you ask the last question, but she says, we will all be offended, but how we react to the offense. And then again, that's when you came and you asked, how do we handle the offense? Shakira says that he will use things that are close, such as family, spouse, children, etc. Michelle Allen says spiritually mature with discernment to filter and identify the root. That's how to handle it.
Mm-hmm.
Spiritually mature with discernment to filter and identify the root.
Okay.
Shakira also says you have to pray your way through it. Every action from the devil does not warrant every action from you. Let the God in you respond. And Corey says, we have to look beyond the flesh and blood to see the spiritual aspect of a conflict. It also helps to have grace and forgiveness stored up for future offenses, especially since Jesus already gave us the heads up that it will happen.
It will happen. So he said, store up. What's that?
Store up. We should already have grace and forgiveness stored up.
Woo, that's good. That's good. Because we and I love someone else. I think it was Michelle said, you know, I have a spirit of discernment. And we have to have wisdom. Wisdom to know that Satan is coming. Now, when we talked about that trap, in that trap, I talked about how Hunter would put that trap out there. Now, do you think the hunter will put it out there, making it obvious that it's a trap?
No.
Right.
Miss EJ says, you must forgive and turn that person over to God by praying for them. Mm. Fighting fire with fire will only create more fire. Putting water on it by prayer will put it out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Amen. Amen. And so... right, in terms of the trap. So, no, you don't put that trap out there, making it obvious for what you're trying to catch, making it obvious that it's a trap. And Satan is so, he is so subtle and so, he's wise in how he operates. And he operates in such a manner where he is going to trap you in ways that you don't even expect. I think it was Ty Warrior said that most of the time the offense that it comes, it'll come quicker with someone who's closer to you.
Shakira,
my cousin Shakira. The offense will come to those that are closer to you. Why? Well, and I know you all know the answer to that, but let me break it down a little bit. See, we're all in the world, we have expectations. We all have it, we have expectations. Each and every one of us, we have expectations. And so when you have someone who's not saved, someone not giving their life to Christ, someone who's not operating in the godly kind of way, even someone who does not even have basically a lot of good morals, they have some but not a lot of good morals. And so your expectation of them to do good or to do you good is probably here. And then so you have someone who is saved, someone in the church, they're saved, and so you got a brother, sister, spiritual brother, sister who's saved. And your expectations of them are here. And so you got the worldly expectations, you got the godly expectations, your Christian expectations. And then you have your family. And then your family, who would have saved, your expectations of them is up here. And so when the world, let's say the world does something and it comes up to a Christian expectation, you kind of like give them credit for it. You begin like, whoa, wow, that's really good. And you kind of like, you really feel pretty good at the fact that this person kind of like came up and did something and they exceeded your expectation. But when someone in your family comes down to that same level that that person in the world came down to or came up to, that is still not enough. Even though it was good enough for the world, it's not good enough for the family.
Right.
And so now you're in a place of offense. Mm-hmm. Because offense comes from when expectations are not met. When someone does not meet your expectation or you fail to see the expectation that you had anticipated, that's when you get offended. Someone, I use a story a lot of times, as a child, parent says, I'm gonna take you to the carnival on Saturday. 10 o'clock, we're gonna go to the carnival on Saturday. Saturday, 10 o'clock comes, and dad has to work. Your expectations are way, way up here, but when dad tells you we're not going, or he doesn't show up, what happens? You become offended, you become hurt. become offended and hurt. And that's the same thing. That's what happens when we get offended. We become offended when our expectations are not met. Any comments? And so as we go, as my wife have taught me this new word, delve, as we delve deeper, is that right? Delve deeper, as we delve deeper, I'm gonna go back to mine, as we dive deeper into this lesson, we're gonna go a lot deeper into the type of things that Satan will bring our way and how we ought to respond. And just learning, again, all this is about learning who Satan is. Not so much knowing who he is, but knowing who he is. Mm-hmm. Knowing how he operates. Knowing how he presses our buttons, as some of us still have. Now, I know I got some buttons, and if the wrong person or the right person press the buttons, I react to it. I respond to it. And so let's find a way where we can gear ourselves to a level of maturity where, number one, he can push as many buttons as he wants, but we're not going to find ourselves in offense. We're not going to find ourselves in offense. Amen? Amen. I got a couple of minutes. I didn't know whether or not anybody else had anything else to say. Yes, Minister Desmond.
I just had one. Regarding the forgiveness part,
mm-hmm.
Scenario. Let's just say this individual, you know, I've forgiven this individual. And this individual continues. Okay, I've reached the seven.
You reached the seven.
Reached the seven limit, you know, or
you forgave I've seven gone, times already.
Right, we surpassed the limit of seven.
Yes.
And it's not been the same thing, but it's been other infractions, so
right,
to say.
Right, right.
Do I let this person in again, in that same space, or because I can forgive a person,
right?
But where is that? I guess where's that threshold? Or that line that I draw to ensure that I'm not put in a position to be not offended, but to be put, to have that button pushed again.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because I know a long time ago, you know, you chewed me out about, you know, keeping people at a distance and not being that person to be a doormat. And, you know, you chewed me out in the spirit. But when it comes down to that, being offended, and forgiving that individual for someone who's a repeat offender,
mm-hmm.
Do we let them in that same space or do we give them some sort of quarantine,
mm-hmm.
in regards to?
This is how I operate. I operate in those type of relationships because I know my level of spiritual maturity. I have to ask God and know in the middle of the relationship, what is my purpose in that person's life?
Right.
Or what is that person's purpose in my life? Most of the time, if I'm the mature Christian, then it's about my purpose in their life. So I have to know what is my purpose in their life. And that's why there's really no limit of forgiveness if you know that your purpose in their life is to lead them to Christ.
Right.
Because you could be, their doormat for the rest of your life,
right.
If God knows that at the end of their life,
right.
Because of the life you portrayed or displayed before them, leads them to salvation,
right.
Then that's the sacrifice that you have to make. But you have to know what is your purpose in that person's life.
Right.
And if you realize that, okay, there's no spiritual purpose in this life for this person, that this is... You have to identify, was this person brought to you by God or brought to you by Satan?
Got it.
Because again, remember, Satan is also bringing people to influence you as well.
Right.
So again, going back to that word discernment, you have to discern and then know within your heart of hearts, what's your purpose in this person's life? And if your purpose in this person's life is only to say, look, God loves you, so do I. You know, the word says, thou shalt confess in your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in your heart that Christ raised, or God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. If that's your only purpose in that person's life,
right,
then you've done your part. But you have to know, only the Holy Spirit can tell you. Because what happens is when you close the door and shut that relationship off, and it's premature, mm-hmm, before God's time,
mm-hmm,
the Holy Spirit will let you know.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll wrestle with it. Mm-hmm. You'll wrestle with it. And what you end up doing the next day, you end up calling that person back, or you'll see that person, or you're trying to restore it. Because the Holy Spirit is going to talk to you. But you have to have a peace about it. You'll know that peace.
Because
it's that peace that passes all understanding.
Right.
Amen? Any comments to that?
Pam was answering Desna's question.
She said, love them, but with a long handled spoon.
I ain't read that in the gospel, sis. I just did not read that in the gospel. Love somebody with a long handled spoon. I ain't read it in the gospel yet.
And Jericho says that's good. I'm thinking that she's saying that Desmond's example was good.
Oh, your example was good.
It appears that Miss EJ is agreeing with what you have said.
Amen.
Yeah, I think it was really good.
Amen. Amen. Look, time is nigh. It's actually time for us to move forward. Love you all with the mighty master's name of Jesus. Thank you so much for tuning in with us today. Looking forward to this coming Sunday. Don't forget, this coming Sunday, if you were not tuned in on this past Sunday, this coming Sunday, which I announced this past Sunday, I will be licensing our four ministers of the gospel and ordaining our very first deacon of the church this coming Sunday during our regular worship service. And so looking forward to doing that, looking forward to having you tune in for that special service that we're going to be having. I believe that these men and women have pleased the Lord in their life and in their character. And therefore, we're going to, as the world sometimes require, we're going to place some license in their hands so that they can have some credentials to say, yeah, not only have God qualified me, but he also continues to guide me in doing the things that he would have for me to do. Love you. God bless you. And don't forget, oh, you know what? I can't go without giving someone an opportunity to give their life to Christ. So if that's you, if you have never given your life to Christ before and you want to tonight, or you want to rededicate your life tonight, look here, simple prayer. It's a simple thing. You can say it with me or you can say it later on. All I want you to do is say this prayer. It's between you and the Father. I'm just kind of guiding you through the steps. But just say and pray this prayer with me. Father God, I give you my life. I believe that Jesus Christ died for my sins. And on the third day, he rose with all power in his hands. I believe, according to your word, in Romans 10:9, that if I shall confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead, I shall be saved. And God, I thank you, God, that because I'm confessing and I'm believing in Jesus Christ, that my sins have been washed away and thrown into the sea of forgetfulness, and that today, Father, I am saved. And today, God, I have been rededicated into your fold. And I thank you now for all that you're going to do for me today and the days to come. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. God bless you. And don't forget, at the Bridge Church of Alabama, we're loving God, loving people, and pursuing the purpose that God has for you. In Jesus' name, love you. Until the next time, God bless.